That's me, or was me, 100 years ago. I have one of the most significant close-ups in the history of silent movies, and one of the longest. The movie, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, made in 1920. I am Cesare, a somnambulist who is wakened from his deep sleep by the madman, Dr. Caligari, who commands me to commit murders that will benefit him. I am his ironclad alibi. I was in almost 100 silent movies. Most are forgotten, many are lost, and many are disintegrating, even as you're watching this. I play villains, especially exotic ones. I play monsters and madmen, historical characters, based very loosely on the facts. Mostly we just borrowed their names. Ivan the Terrible, Cesare Borgia. Young love-struck students, willing to sell their souls for love. And yes, like many of the actors of the time, I exaggerated my gestures and my expressions. Of course, it's all discredited now, and we can laugh at it. But I had something else very few others had, an intensity, a face that looked, well, intelligent. And my face at rest didn't look blank. It looked like I was thinking. You can read my thoughts. It's a rare quality in actors. And I had something no one else had. When I was excited, the veins in my temples and forehead throbbed. Very effective, especially in close-ups. I was so well known and respected that John Barrymore wanted me to play in his film about François Villon. Even though I didn't speak English at the time. On the other hand, it was a silent movie, so it didn't matter. And yes, he did have a great profile. That said, what a ham. Another historically important film, different from the others. It is said to be the first film dealing with homosexuality. I am a famous violinist, in love with a student. But I am being blackmailed by another homosexual. I have everything to lose, my reputation, my career, my life. The blackmailer was the actor-director Reinhold Schünzel. We were in a couple of films together. In the early sound era, he directed Victor and Victoria, which was the basis, 50 years later, for Julie Andrews' very successful film.
The rest of the tale's not a pretty one.
Even though he was Jewish, he became one of the most prominent directors of the early Nazi era in Germany. Goebbels valued him so highly, he was willing to make him an honorary Aryan, whatever that means. Instead, he fled to America and wound up playing Nazis in Hollywood movies, the most prominent of which was Hitchcock's Notorious.
Miss Huberman, may I present
Dr. Anderson?
Dr. Anderson.
Gives me great pleasure.
25 years earlier, and before Hitler. As for me, I was the king of German expressionist movies. I would do anything if I thought it was interesting. And a lot of interesting projects came my way. But Caligari meant my reputation, even though the part was relatively small. The movie is famous for several reasons. Its theatrical sets with foreshortened perspectives, with painted shadows and distorted architectural details. It's a world as if perceived by a madman. It had a great influence on subsequent horror films and, ultimately, the look of film noir. Later, it was suggested that the film was a prescient reading of Germany after World War I, where a tyrannical madman controls all the inmates of a mental institution and hypnotizes them into doing his bidding.
Thank you.
One of my favorites is The Hands of Orlok, directed by Robert Wiener, who directed Caligari. I'm a world-famous pianist who's been in a train crash and his hands were crushed. A brilliant surgeon grafts on another pair of hands, but they're the hands of a killer. I can no longer play. My thoughts are violent. Or is it my hands? The hands want to kill. I don't. But they do. I am possessed by demons. It was a very influential horror film and was remade in 1935 in America as Mad Love with Peter Lorre. The favorite of my silent films, of the ones that still remain, is The Man Who Loves. Filmed in America, it's based on Victor Hugo's novel, L'Homme qui rit. It was made in 1928, just at the end of the silent era, my last silent film. To punish my father, gypsies carved my lips and mouth from ear to ear, as if I was perpetually smiling. I became a clown. What else could I do? I made people laugh, whether I wanted to or not. And I could never ever change my expression, even when I was unhappy. I had to wear a special prosthetic device, which was very painful. I couldn't eat or talk, but once again, it was a silent movie in a language I didn't speak. The sacrifices one makes for one's art. It's still, to this day, very moving. The director, Paul Leni, was very talented and a good friend of mine. He was a German Jew who left Germany for Hollywood long before Hitler came to power. Unfortunately, he died at the age of 44. My look and my makeup were the inspiration for this, if you can believe it. The Joker, Batman's nemesis. It was my first unwitting flirtation with the canon of popular culture, but not the last. I don't pretend to be a philosopher, but isn't it strange that sound films started being made 2 years before the Depression and in Germany 3 years before the advent of Hitler? I didn't have any problem in talking pictures because I was a classically trained actor, unlike many of the beautiful foreign-born stars in Hollywood who could barely speak English. Or worse yet, came from Brooklyn or the Bronx. My transition to sound was a very easy and comfortable one, and it offered me more diverse roles as well.
Gesundheit. Freiwillige zum Reinholen.
Meine kleine, große Unbekannte.
Behalt das Mädel im Auge und hilf ein bisschen nach, wenn es nötig sein sollte. Verstanden?
And I think I grasped very quickly the difference between silent movie acting and sound movie acting.
Denkt, ich sei ein Mordskerl, Kompanieführer. Und sie weiß nicht, dass meine ganze Courage zum Teufel ist, wenn ich die paar Stufen darauf gehe, dass ich vor Angst beinahe verrückt werde.
In 1933, Hitler came to power. That same year, I married again, for the third time, to a Jewish woman. Goebbels advised me to divorce her, or else my acting career would be severely curtailed. Of course, I refused. In an official document, where they asked what race I was, I wrote Jude, Jew. Neither Hitler nor Goebbels were amused. My wife and I fled to England.
Für euch bin ich von heute an gestorben.
Hitler and Goebbels made me an honorary Jew.